Log Talk Radio.
Hello, hello, hello. It's another glorious day, my tea sippers, and you know what time it is. I hope you have all of your comfort together because it's time to dish the tea. And your dish is darlings. With Big Mush.
Can't wait, can't wait. Time to dish tea with Big Mush.
I was the one that gave.
out there in Blog Talk Radio land, here in the glorious United States of America and across the globe. Hello to all of my listeners and tea sippers out there in Germany and Italy and France and the United Kingdom and in Paraguay and in the Caribbean island, and to all of you within the sound of my voice. It is another glorious day, my tea sippers. So I know you have all of your comforts, my darlings, because it's time to dish tea. And you're dishing tea, darlings, with Big Meats. What's going on, babies? Hey. Yes, my darlings, honey. I got a special pep in my stepchild. Y'all know down at the donut factory. Them children, honey, had me making all kinds of donuts, baby. I've been working 7 days a week for the last 7.5 months. And I think it has been a total of having only 7 days off. Do you understand? So when I tell you today starts my much-earned vacation, baby, a bitch got a new pep in her step, and I'm, okay, I got a new way to wear my hair. Honey, ain't that what they say? So, my darlings, honey, we're coming to you on this special occasion because tomorrow I will be in Orlando, Florida. We do have the Big Boy Pride event going on down on Orange Blossom Trail over there at the Parliament House. So I will be there. So on Wednesday, I would not be broadcasting our regularly scheduled show. However, today I wanted to come in because our guest last week had a medical necessity, and we had to postpone and bring her in when she was available. And I was like, girl, I got to have you here. So that's why we're having today's show. I want to give a special shout out to the American Intercontinental University because I'm broadcasting live from the school, honey. We're down here, here in Atlanta. We're in finals week, so all of us are sitting up here doing projects and carrying on. So if you hear background noise and carrying on, that's why. So thank you to American Intercontinental University, where I am a student. And all of those shenanigans, okay? But we're going to make sure that we give you all that you need, all that you want, all that you desire, honey. So in addition to dishing tea, baby, I got a bunch of crumpets, honey. So, honey, make sure you are sitting at the table because there's room for you right here and right now. Let me go over here. I got to open up the tea room. So if you're listening by computer, the tea room is now open. Come on in and dish your tea over here with me responsibly, honey. If you don't have a page, just go ahead and sign up. It's free of charge to sign up, just like any social media page, and come on up in here. Now, let me say this right here and right now. When you come in the tea room, please dish your tea responsibly because I do not want to come up in here and find out that y'all don't know how to handle yourselves. Y'all know this is the written word, and oftentimes we end up thinking somebody trying to come out of a bag on us or neck rollers or something because you do not hear how they're talking. We miss that. You know, you don't know their vocal affectations or how they may say certain words. You don't know if the tone is joking or not. And based on your own personal experiences, you may think or feel that someone is trying to come out of a bag on you, honey, and that may not necessarily be the case. So just remember, honey, dish your tea responsibly. It's okay to disagree. Just don't be disagreeable, honey, because if I come in and find out that you are cutting up, I will cut you out. I see we got the winning team over there in the tea room, honey. Hey there, winning team. Go ahead on, baby. I see you over there. If you got questions, you can put them up over there. I'm going to be bouncing back and forth and carrying on, so that's going to be lovely. Okay? Let me say this right here and right now, that Dishing Tea with Big Meats is for mature audiences, and the language and or subject matters that you hear on this program are not intended for children or anyone who is not mature and or responsible enough to handle the situation at hand. So your listening discretion is advised. I will repeat. Dishing Tea with Big Meats is for mature audiences, and the language and or subject matters that you hear on this program are not intended for children or anyone who is not mature and or responsible enough to handle of the situation at hand. So your listening discretion is advised. Honey, y'all know I'm still in my birthday mode. I've just extended it. Yes, I can do that. So, honey, I am 48 years young. I have earned the right to every 3, 4, 5, 15, 17, 52, 190 second, 95 syllable letter and or syllable word that comes out of my mouth, honey. So I don't know what bag I'm coming out of, child. Just know that I'm coming out of one of them. So if you're at work you know, you have the volume up, now is the time for you to turn your listening volume down to a respectful level, or better yet, just put your headphones on, sugar. Okay, if you're out and about at home and you have children around, honey, put the kids in the other room, honey, with the other flat screen, and let them watch Dora or SpongeBob or Bert and Ernie or, okay, Big Bird and Snuffleupagus, honey, Kate and Allie, Cagney and Lacey, somebody, honey, Laverne and Shirley, I don't give a damn. Put them over there, honey, because now it's time for the grown and sexy to become the seasoned and sophisticated, okay? Did this child just text me and say, we got to finally win this class? Yeah, I'm sorry. Somebody just gave me a text. Yeah, I told you we down here at the school. But that is what this is all about, okay? So please, honey, govern yourselves accordingly, because I am not going to entertain anybody coming up to me, honey, at the Walmart, the Walgreens, honey, the Family Dollar, the Dollar Tree, the Dollar General, honey. Okay, Saks Fifth Avenue, at the Marta bus station, honey, if I'm on the airplane, none of you bitches will come to me and say, honey, that you got demerits, you got written up, somebody pointed fingers and talked about you or whatever because of something that I said and or done. I will not accept it. I will not accept it. I will not accept it, honey. Govern yourselves accordingly. You understand? So, having said all that, okay, I don't have any special announcements as of yet. Outside of, please, please, please go to my website, www.dishingtea.com. Again, that's www.dishingtea.com, because my new book, Awakenings, Epiphanies, and Longer Spiritual Journey. This is the companion piece, Revelations, Affirmations, and Confirmations, is now available. And you can get there online with us right now. Okay? And I love it. Okay, I love it. So thank you all for coming on out. Now, let me get to getting, because I want to make sure that we get this together. If I sound distracted, it's because I'm trying to do 2 or 5 different things at the same time. Okay, so let me get my sponsors to come on up in here, say a couple of things, and then when we come back, my darlings, my darlings, my darlings, this is a dream come true for me, because my next guest, honey, you may not know her by name, but sweetheart, when I tell you this sister here, honey, this sister right here has been amongst the greats because she is a great. Okay, this girl has been singing with some of everybody. And when I say some of everybody, I mean yes. Okay, so be that as it may. With that, hold on. I was going to go to a commercial break, but let me do this because I'm trying to keep everybody happy. I'm going to do this. Let me just do this. Today's show, I say aging is optional, okay, up close and personal with the one and only Ms. Tawatha Agee. Great day and grand rises to you all, T-Sippers. Today's show is going to be a real doozy for me, as I have been in love with this woman for many, many years. As I'm sure many of you have been as well. She's the former lead singer for MTUME and has built her career as a background vocalist to the stars.
She has toured with Aretha Franklin, the late great Luther Vandross, the Dave Matthews Band, Lenny Kravitz, and Steely Dan. She has been singing, arranging, contracting, and composing music for so many people, including My LIL Big Sistah and friend to the show, Miss Stephanie Mills, my mama, Miss Patti LaBelle, Jennifer Holliday, Diana Ross, Melba Moore, the late great Al Jarreau, the late great Michael Jackson, the late great Phyllis Hyman, just to name a few. She's also recorded her own project, Welcome to My Dream, and after dropping her only solo project, she continued to soar musically as one of the most sought-after vocalists in the business. It is my greatest pleasure to present to most and introduce to the millennials. This is the incomparable Miss Tawatha Agee. Hello there, my darling. Welcome,
hello,
welcome.
Hello, Big Me. How you doing?
Honey, I am everything, and everything is me. What's going on with you, girl?
I'm so happy to be with you today. This is great for me. I mean, I love it. I love your voice. I love your energy. This is really cool. So hit me with the questions. I'm ready for you, baby.
You ready for a girl? Okay, now you know, but hold on. Because let me just give you a little bit of praise for a minute. Because, see, I really believe in giving folks their flowers while they are alive, okay?
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And also, let me do a special shout out to my baby, honey, Angelo Ellaby over there at Double Exposure Media Relations.
Absolutely. We love him.
Possible
yes.
For me. Okay, yes. So, Angelo, thank you, baby.
Thank you, Angelo.
Tawatha, I have got to sit down here and tell you, sweetheart, that there has been very few people who are like me. I'm an old school bitch, honey. I read the liner notes, okay?
Oh,
and I miss
yes.
the liner
okay.
notes with this digital formatting and carrying on. But girl,
uh-huh.
when I tell you I have seen your name on everything, when I tell you I'm one who get off on the screaming bitches in the background because they set the tone of the song. When I tell you that, Miss Sting, honey, you have been just part of the architectural tapestry for mainly everybody who I love. Now, my mama and Stephanie Mills are dear to my heart, okay? They are the quintessential number one and number two. When they hold that number one slot simultaneously,
mm-hmm.
Patty and Stephanie. Then you got Luther on the back, baby.
Oh, yes.
Then you got Miss Aretha, girl. Now, I'm from Detroit, child, so that's the home girl right there. So, okay, when
yes.
I tell you, sister, that you have just been one of those people, honey, who I have just adored. I marvel at your perseverance. I marvel at your splendor for being in this business. I have to consider you amongst the greats and one of the greats because you've done so much with the greats. So, honey, to be with the greats, you have to be great. So, my darling, when I say that I just adore you and just love how you have made your spot here in the musical in the musical industry, I was just telling this to somebody, honey. You were Mickey Howard before Mickey Howard hit the scene, girl. Because I was listening to you, I said, "Girl, you know what I'm saying?" Because that's the influence that you have had and carried on. So, honey, I just want to give you all of that first and say,
"Why, thank you so much.
Thank you." Okay,
well,
so just
you make a girl
feel girl.
Good. You make a girl feel good. Come on now, I love it.
So now let's get into this because as I have been listening to some things over the years and carrying on, one of my other sisters, honey, the screamer half of herself, honey, Miss Angela Winbush. I know you and Angela and Richard Smallwood, honey, have long term
oh, yes.
history. You know,
sang together. We sang
yes.
together in college.
Yeah, so let's take us back to those particular days when you realized that you were gifted with the talent for singing and song. What did that mean to you, and how were you able to shape that?
Well, you know, I'm a church girl, and the first time I went away from home was when I went to college, and I went
mm-hmm.
to Howard. I went to Howard, and I would be in the College of Fine Arts. So I'd be in the practice room playing, And one day this girl walked into my room, I'm in my practice room, and it was Angela. We became fast friends. We stayed in the same dormitory. And so, I mean, you know, we clicked right away. And then she went to Richard's church. So, I mean, I would go with her to church, and we'd see Richard, because Richard had had graduated, but he would, you know, he was still around. He would do recitals and things like that. He would accompany people, because this was a long time ago, long, long, like Bernie Mac say, long, long, long time ago. So we formed a group with several other people, Elette Ricks, who was from Buffalo, New York, and Shelton Becton, who was from North Carolina. So we had a group. We just sang gospel around the city. We were singing churches around D.C., the D.C., Maryland, Virginia area. And, you know, we were students. So, I mean, we just decided, like, okay, we're doing this gospel stuff. Let's see if we can, you know, do some, you know, like R&B stuff. And that's how I met MTUME. We had a group called Hot Tea, you know.
Yes.
And
Hot the tea, baby. Yes. Hot tea. Come on.
We were ahead of our time. It was Hot Tea. And so we had a group, and we were going to a producer by the name of James MTUME was coming down to listen to us. And so we worked with MTUME. We did some demos. Now, that didn't work out, you know, the demos for MTUME. But it just so happened that MTUME and I lived in the same town. So when I came home from school, I called him, and he says, well, you know, I think I'm going to get a group together. Would you like to sing in my group? And I said, yes. And that's how I became a part of the MTUME band. But it's, you know, it was fate, Big Meech. It's just fate. I had no aspirations of being like a soloist, you know, because like you, I read liner notes, and I always wanted to see my name in the liner notes. And finally, and then I realized my name is in the liner notes. So, I mean, you know, it took a few years, but, I mean, that's all I wanted to do. I never wanted to be in the front, but, you know, the fates decided that I should be, you know, especially when, you know, the band started hitting, and we had a You, Me, and He, and then we had Juicy Fruit, and then I did a solo record. But in the meantime, I'm singing with all these other people. I met Luther. I sang on every Luther album except for maybe two or three. And,
yes, I know, honey.
And that was only because Juicy Fruit had come out and I was on tour with him too, man. That's why I didn't sing on a Luther album that year. So, I mean, you know, I've stayed busy. I'm so fortunate. I've been blessed, you know, doing what I love to do. It's not like it was work, you know?
Okay.
It's just something I love to do. Yeah.
Okay, then let's go here, because everybody has been asking me that question. Everybody said, okay, did she do her solo project or whatever? And what was it about that solo thing that didn't work? Because you did the same thing. Lisa Fisher, who was your singing buddy, back with
yes!
Lisa. Okay, another one. Get one solo project, honey. I did just say, you know what? No, baby, let me stick where I am.
Because you know what? Sometimes it's like, You think that's what you want, and then when you do it, it's like, no, I don't think so. So it's
right,
like,
okay.
girl has a right to change her mind.
is it your prerogative, girl? Go ahead.
Yes, it is. It's my prerogative. I do what I want to do.
Okay. Because, child, you, Lisa Fisher, Ava Cherry did one. She was another one. One solo album, child, and
yeah.
No more. The Waters, yeah. the Waters, child, Maxine and Julia and Oren, another one. So with that camaraderie with background vocalists and Kenna, because y'all on everything, honey. If you're not on there together, y'all are intertwined and have been interfacing.
Exactly.
What
exactly.
Is that for y'all or for you? In particular, we're dealing with the world of background vocalists and carrying on. Is there such a thing, or is the public just taking that for granted?
Oh, I think the public takes it for granted. I mean, it's like we have a camaraderie because we love what we do, you know,
mm-hmm.
and it's like, you know, we sing behind whoever and then go on to the next person, you know, unless we're going on tour, because that's I like that. I like the variety of it. You know what I mean? Singing with somebody different all the time. I like that. And also, it pays the bill. You know, if you just work for one person, then you might be blocking, you know, that money coming in from somebody else. So if you're singing on the record, I mean, you know, you have an opportunity to work with more people. And then if you have a tour, and you know, and we in the agreement is right, you know, the business is right, then we can do mm-hmm. the tour. But if not, you know, it's like, let's just do these records. And the thing is, most people think you should be in the front, Big Meech, but listen, that's not it all the time. Sometimes you can do more by being in the background or being behind the scenes. It's not always
about
being in front, because the money is there to be made. I mean, everybody doesn't have to be a star. You know what I'm saying? Because
mm-hmm,
the star,
mm-hmm.
that's like, you know, that can flame out quickly. But if you're working in the support, or you like when you see American Idol or any of these award shows,
yes.
where you see the band and you see singers, I mean, those people can work for everybody all year, and you don't even know who they are, but they're working.
Right, but they're
proving
their face
to
work. Honey. Okay.
the point is to work. It's not like, for me, the point was to work. It wasn't to be famous. My point was to be, I wanted to see my name on those liner notes, like I used to read when I was coming up. So,
right.
I mean, there's so many other things you can do aside from being in the front. Because that sort of, unless you're Katy Perry, Beyonce, or, you know,
mm-hmm.
but that's different. Or Usher, or D'Angelo, or whoever the people are right now, you know, you know, it's just like you gotta realize that there's more than one way to be in the business. You know, most kids are thinking, oh, I want to be a star. But, you know, don't limit yourself. You're not going to be a star automatically. You know, you got to build up to that. You got to work towards that. So the thing is, there's so many other things that can be done behind the main artist. You can be in the band. You can be a background singer. You can be in management. You can be part of the crew. You can do the lights. You could do the staging. You could be the choreographer. It's so many people that are involved that makes the person in the front work. So there are jobs that can be had without being in the front.
Now, see, you just said that for me, because here's the thing. Now let's go here, because being able, I like how you said that. I wanted to work. It's not necessarily be a famous. I just need the car and had to pay this bill. Okay.
Right. Right.
So let's go here. How is it that you've been able to maintain your voice? Because you dealt with Steely Dan, honey. You dealt with the Dave Matthews, honey. Then you go and be as sophisticated with Aretha, and then of course Luther with his special little curly cues and carrying on. How is it that you've been able to, honey? Luther's sizes for those arrangements and carrying on, honey, because he's very precise, and his precision, honey, on what he wanted, a girl. That's a couple. I live for y'all background, child, because, okay. So, you know, how is it you've been able to maintain, or what is your exercise to keep
your
instrument intact?
The voice is, like you said, my voice is an instrument. I have to take care of it. I mean, you can't be up all night singing and dancing in a smoke-filled room and then have to do a gig the next day, because that definitely affects your voice. And it's not like your voice is something that you can plug in. You can plug into an amp, you know, like the musicians do. It's like, no, the singers, I mean, you're carrying your voice around with you 24/7. So it's not like you can plug in an amp and say, and then turn the volume up. You can't do that. So you really have to understand what your voice is. You can't just say, I'm a singer, and then just going out there and be, you know, drinking and hanging out all night and then having a gig the next day, because it's not going to work. It's not going to work, because your voice is an instrument. You got to take care of it. You got to, and this might sound boring, but, you know, there's a regimen that you should follow. You should do vocal exercises so your voice can remain flexible, because you never know when somebody's going to call you to sing. You know, you never know. So you got to stay ready to be ready. You got to stay ready to be ready.
How about that? Stay ready to be ready. Get out of here. Stay ready to be ready. Get
to
out,
be
girl.
Ready.
Okay,
yeah.
that's you. Okay.
Yeah.
Now, along with that, let me follow up with this particular question as far as dealing with the voice and warm up and carrying on, because we have folks, Aretha and Patti and all Frankie Beverly and Karen, all these children,
right,
honey, who are not in their 70s and this, that, and the other, who still sound phenomenal. But, you know, they've been trying to rasp Miss Patti, so what's up? Well, she can't hit them notes like she's, honey, she's 74. Okay.
Right.
And the voice changes over time. Now, mama will still wear you out. Now, don't get it twisted. My mama's still rough. Okay.
Yes.
She may not be,
yes,
the 5 octave, but she's 4.5, 3, 4.5. But she's still,
exactly,
working. How is it that you've been able to maintain with the changes that your voice go through? Stephanie Mills told me, she said, honey, I just have to work with it. She says, you know, I'm fortunate to where I could still sing my songs in the same key. I haven't had to change keys, you know. So
yeah.
I'm
yeah.
fortunate. So for you, you know, how is that for you? Or is it because you don't necessarily have to have that particular pressure as the background vocalist because you're hired in for the gig, so you just they teach you the song and then it's something else?
Well, let me tell you, sometimes working with Aretha can sing a song for 10 minutes. I mean, hard singing, background part.
Yes.
So it's like, whoa, if she's doing something like Old Landmark or something, it's like, oh, my God,
oh,
this is the longest song in history.
She would do that when she go to church. Exactly.
But you know, you like I said, you got to take care of your instrument. Like a sax player has to warm up. He keeps his instrument in a case. He keeps the mouthpiece in another separate pouch. I mean, you gotta take care of this because this is your money maker. This is what you do to make a living. And so you know, some people are blessed enough to not have to warm up or anything, but after you've done it for so many years, you got to warm up the car so it can run. You know what I
How
mean?
About that?
You gotta keep the voice in good shape. And so, I mean, you can do vocal exercises, you can have a vocal coach. I mean, it's like, you know, sometimes you gotta go there you get rusty, because if you don't use it, you'll lose it. If you don't use
mm-hmm.
that voice, you'll lose it. But I've been fortunate enough to work on a constant level, and I know what to do. I mean, you know, you got to warm up. That's all. You got to warm up. You got to cool down, you know, so you can be prepared
mm.
for anything. Because you never know who's going to call you. You never know.
True that.
I've done the television commercials and, you know, and jingles, and so – you know, you never know when somebody's going to call you for a job. So your voice has got to be in tip-top shape because, you know what, if it's not, they're going to call the next person.
How about that?
They're going to call the
okay.
next person. They're going to, so you got to be ready.
Now, when you were listing the singers and you were saying the Beyoncés and the Ushers and carrying on, and I noticed
mm-hmm.
that you wanted to stay current with this generation of singers, as the person that you are, music has changed so much. How
mm-hmm.
is it that you're able to adapt to the changes of what they want with the music? Because for the most part, background, honey, if you get a good tagline, honey, they can make you sing a line or two and then loop the hell out that damn line and then you're done. You know what I'm saying?
But that's what they do now. But back in the day, we had to sing that stuff over and over. You know, the 12-inch, the club records. The club record, just like, you know, we actually, if the song was 10 minutes, we actually sang for that amount of time. So now
uh-huh, uh-huh.
you can sing a phrase and they'll loop it and, you know. But when you have to perform it live, you still got to sing it. So that's
right.
why your voice got to be ready. I mean, they can do all that auto-tune stuff and whatever. But when you actually have to perform, you got
mm-hmm.
to be ready. Because I've been in situations where there was another artist who had his material on tape, and the tape malfunctioned.
Broke.
And so the audience is like, what's going on? Then they had to start the tape from the beginning, you know, so it's like, no. That's
oh, my God.
So it's like,
that's
why you got to really.
Oh, I'm picturing that show, child. Oh, no.
It was a mess.
I'm
the audience was
that.
Very
I,
upset.
I know they were. I know.
Yeah.
Hell, I'd have been. Okay.
So, people like Stephanie.
God.
Stephanie's a real flat-footed singer. Stephanie can sing. She don't even need the band. She could wear you out just singing a cappella. you know, because she's a great singer. And so is Miss Patti. And it's like, you don't have to sing the songs in the same key. What difference does it make if you change the key? As long as you can still sing the song. As long as people still like it. So, I mean, you know, hey.
But you know, let's go there, because I've named a few of the children that you've been able to work with and carry on. What were some of the lessons that you learned from each particular? If there was a lesson, if I were to call a name and say, what did you learn from this particular singer and that particular singer? Are you able to do that, or does it become a hodgepodge at this point?
No. Because you know what, you got to be open. There's always something else to learn. You know what I'm saying? I'm not. Mm-hmm. I can't say I know everything because I work with all these people. But now there's a new crop that the industry has changed, but the instrumentation and the technology has changed. So there are a lot of things that I do that people don't have to do anymore because they got it on tape. But let me tell you, working with Luther was such a teacher. I always say I went to Luther Vandross University, and because he taught us what it was like to be, what it was supposed to be like to be the background singer, to be the support singer. Just because he made sure. Look, Luther would have a check before we went out on stage. Fingernails, toenails. Make sure you had the pedicure. Make sure every crease was where it was supposed to be. And of course, we already had the vocal parts. So, I mean, you know, because when you're working with Luther, you got to be ready, because that's like the ultimate in background singing. That was it for me. It's like Luther.
Wow.
Oh my God. He said, you know, because he knew. Look, Big Meech, he would know if you sang with him. He knew exactly what you could do, and he told you exactly what part to sing. And then after doing that, he would give you leeway to be a little flexible in case you wanted to add a little extra to it. That's how great Luther was. He knew exactly what he wanted at all times. At all times. That's why you loved his performances and you loved his records, because he always knew what was supposed to be there. He always knew what it was supposed to be. And, you know, you pick that up. You pick that up. So when you're working with the next person, it's like, well, this is what worked for Luther, so I know it's going to work for Aretha. I know it's going to work for whoever. And the thing is, when you're working with different people, because all the time it's not R&B. You might work for a country a pop group or a rock and roll. I mean, when people say I want to be a singer, you got to be prepared to do more than one thing. You know, it's not just going to be like the R&B thing. And if you're going to audition for somebody, research the person you're going to audition for so you know what kind of music it is. So when you go in there, it's like, well, I don't sing like that. You know, you go in there prepared. You go in prepared. So so if you're working, if you're going out with, you're doing an audition for, Dave Matthews. You know, it's they're a pop rock group. And the ultimate is Steely Dan. Can you do those
Steely
intervals
Dan,
that
girl,
they do?
Yes.
You know. Now, that's real singing right there. That's some real singing.
That.
But it's like, it's different. It's different. So you have to be accustomed to the being flexible vocally so you can sing in each genre. You want to be able to sing in each genre because you don't want to limit your working possibilities.
Mm-hmm.
You don't just sing R&B. You can just sing whoever's coming through. I used to do the David Letterman show. I used to do Saturday Night Live. We'd be singing on there behind different artists. Also, the thing is not being on camera. I used to sing on Saturday Night Live, and I would sing in the booth, so no one ever saw me. I could walk in there with my pajamas on, and nobody would care, you know, because all I had to do was go in the booth and sing. You know what I mean? So it's not about being seen. It's about being paid. It's about being paid. You know what I mean? It's about being paid, you know.
You know, you are really giving me a new perspective on this whole thing of background. I've been a background singer, because I'm going to tell you, coming from Detroit, most of the children that I know who claim to be background singers, first off, they come from the church. And because they sing it with Karen Clark Sheard and all these girls, honey, they go here with the Linens and all these girls. And, you know, we have that sense of air. You know, they walk around, honey, and they want to name drop and all this old jazz. And because of that, it gave me this thing of, oh, wow, you know, oh, well, you sang with Gladys. Okay, yeah, I got a friend of mine who does this. Well, they're on tour with so-and-so. And it became this whole name-dropping thing. And more so, they're looking for the fame of it. But you just sat down here and just said, damn, some fame, honey. I'm trying to get paid. Okay?
Exactly.
It's all
exactly.
about getting my coin. I'm going to work just like you go up in there and punch your time clock, honey. If you working in the laundry, honey, you ain't worried about no damn clothes. You just trying to get that check. Okay?
Yeah, exactly.
So if I'm
now,
coming
let me
up
tell
in
you,
here.
Let me tell you.
Go ahead, baby.
I mean, you could meet me and not know if I, you know, you knew my name, but if you just met me and I just walk into a room or something, you would never know what I did for a living, because I don't talk about it. I just do it. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
I just do it. I do it. So it's like I don't say, well, I've worked with this person and that person. I mean, for an interview, yes, I will tell you all the people that I've worked with. But, you know, you got some people who name drop, and it's like, who did you work with? It's like, and why, and who are you working with now? And why did you leave, and why aren't you working with the person that you've name dropping about? What's going on with that, you know?
Right.
So the thing is, when you're working with somebody, you gotta stay in good graces. So let me put it like this. My work was by word of mouth. All of my work was by word of mouth. I never had a business card. I never had a manager coming up, because all the work was word of mouth. And there was no social media. So, I mean,
exactly.
You know, I couldn't
put it out on.
I couldn't put it on YouTube. It's like, no, you're not. The only way you're going to see me is if you saw the show, you know. And people that I worked with would recommend me to other artists. And so, you know, you get work by word of mouth only because you're doing a good job. And, you know, you got to be able to leave a situation where and be able to come back. I worked with David in 1998, 2000, okay? And 15 years later, they give me a call. Oh, can you get some girls together and do a tour? That's like, sure.
Oh, wow. Okay.
It's sure.
Okay, right.
But also, you got to keep your physical appearance up as much as you can, you know, because it is show business. You know
right.
You know, you got to keep that together.
Okay, now let's go there. Let's go there. You know, the children, honey. You know. But I'm a house head, okay, and we always tease the girls, honey, and say that they sit in the studio eating a bucket of chicken, honey, just waiting for their moment to come up and say, okay, you know what? Let's get this done, right? So when it's all said and done. Now, you know, with the business sitting up there going through and saying, you know, you've gained too much weight or whatever the case may be, you know, the Kelly Prices and this, that, and the other, to where the physicality is saying something because the record label don't want this or they don't know how to market that. How is that for a background vocalist? Because it's now, just like you said, if you don't know what I do, you ain't going to know me. So why does that become such a stickler now? You know what I'm saying?
Because you know what? Because now people are looking for something specific, and they'll say, I want, they'll either say, I want someone tall. No, let me tell you this. When I met Luther, we had done a couple of sessions together, and then I heard that he was looking for background singers, so I called up his management, and and it's like, well, this is Tawatha, and I'm interested in working with Luther as a background vocalist. And they said, how tall are you? And I said, 5'2". Well, Luther has a height requirement, so you can't audition. So it's like, what, a height requirement?
Wow.
What are you talking about? But I sing. No. He Luther wanted something specific for his background vocals on stage. You know, you've seen his show where he had the people on stage in the costumes, but he would also
have. Yeah, I was just
going to
say, because they got to support their gown, honey. He was one for the
gowns. Exactly.
Yeah,
so
he wants them legs for them gowns, girl.
Exactly. But the other singers were sitting in the pit. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, right. Yeah,
he had
things
in the pit, and he had people on stage. And I'm here to tell you that here's some tea for you. With the people that he had on stage, you know, in the designer costume, all of those people, one of those people never had their mic on, but they look
good.
Wow.
They look
okay,
good.
There's
right.
some tea for you. There's some tea for you. Okay.
Ooh.
So they looked good, but, you know, the people sitting in the pit were singing the parts, you know.
Get out of here. See,
I
heard that they did all that kind of stuff, especially like in studio work and things. Before Denise Williams became Denise, you know, when Minnie wasn't able to produce vocally or whatever, that was Denise on those notes or
wow.
whatever, you know. And yes,
yeah.
when I found that out, I was like, girl, you're kidding me, you know.
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
The point is that
when someone is hiring you as a singer, they might have very specific requirements. So they might want three heavier girls, you know, or
right.
they might want a white girl. They want a white girl with the, you know, the punk rock look. Or it depends on who you're working with. The people who hire you have the right to say what they want. You know, this is the look I'm looking for. You know, not to say that you can't do it, but if you don't fit the requirement that they're asking, it's like then that's not for you. I mean, I've worked
wow.
on TV shows where they say they want two black girls and a white girl, and it's like, oh God,
okay.
I'm not gonna do this.
Not the Oreo sisters, honey. Come on.
Right, and that's what they want. That's what they want for the show. So, I mean, it's, you know, what can you do? That's what they're requesting. Now, when you have your own show, then you can have whoever you want singing. But, you know, people have requirements. That's why when you do auditions, you know, you have to, you know, read the call list and see what it is they're looking for. We're looking for two tall black girls, ethnic looking, or they want somebody with long straight hair. I mean, you know,
right.
you can't, you know, but that's what wigs are for. So, I mean, you know, we could fix that.
Okay.
That's what wigs are for.
Okay. Now, here's the question that I always ask entertainers, particularly women in this business, especially now that we're up on this Me Too movement and all of that. And that is, you know, entertainment is known as sex, drugs, rock and roll. You know, as a woman in this business, and, you know, and you've seen, you know, the ups and the downs and carrying on where folks can get outrageous because they don't know how to handle their liquor or they party too hard and got too much
right.
drugs in their system. How
right.
is it that you've been able to maintain your sense of integrity throughout all of that and not get caught up?
You know what? I never had to deal with any of that. Never. Ever. Because
exactly.
I was working with a band that looked out for me. So I never had to deal with any of that. And then, you know, working on tours, I've been fortunate. I've just never had to deal with it. And then I also have the presence of mind to be able to handle the situation if it has to be handled. Somebody's messing with one of my girls, we're not going to have that. Then they're going to have to deal with me. Because nine times out of ten, I hired the girls. I selected the girls for the tour. You know what I'm saying? So I'm
right,
responsible
right.
for these women. So I'm not going to let anything happen with my girls. We're not going to have that. And before we go out on tour, it's like, look, there's certain rules that you have to follow. You can't fraternize with the band. These people are not your friend. This is a business. All you have to do is sing your part. That's all you have to do. Sing your part,
ooh.
You know. And so if you understand that, then you can work with anybody. But you can't come in and like, oh, I'm going to get a star. You know, you can't come in with, you know, everything hanging out and you're working with a bunch of men and not expect to get, you know what I'm saying? It's kind of
exactly.
You can't be like that. So it's like, look, if you're working with me, I got, you know, I'm called a contractor for a reason. There's certain set of rules that one must follow if you're going to work with me. So if you can't do that, then we're not going to get along. You know, it's like the background singers, it's a set unit, and I will make sure that they're taken care of. And all you got to do is do what I say because I hired them for the gig. You know what
right.
I'm saying? It's real simple.
Exactly.
It's real simple.
I was just really great to go there about that because I've heard that, you know, a girlfriend of mine, when she was singing, she went by Dee Dee Denard back in the day.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, she would say, she used to tell me about the day she and Maxine used to work together. She said, as far as handling that business, she said, the only bitch I knew who was stronger than me or just like me was Maxine Waters. I said,
yes.
Really? She said, mm-hmm. Baby, when it came down to it, it came down to it. So when it comes down to contracting out and hiring other vocalists and carrying on, what is that mindset? Because a lot of us don't realize that, you know, like as you said, there's other different avenues of how to get into the business. So what is it that you
right.
look for? Because oftentimes, you know, folks just say, oh, because I got my friends, girl, I know you can say, come on up in here, do this. And sometimes it can be that simple, but most of the time it's not. So what is that to contract out somebody for a gig?
Okay, so when I'm the contractor, you know, the artist tells me what they want. This is what we're mm-hmm. looking for. And I already know what kind of music it is. And so what I try to do is find out who would fit best, whose personalities are going to work best together, and who's the most professional. You know, and you can't – sometimes you got to have – well, you know, there's rules. You know, it's like they're looking for A, B, and C. I make sure that A, B, and C is there for them. And sometimes you got friends that you sing with, and sometimes they don't fit, you know, in what the artist is looking for. So I just try to make sure that whoever I get as a background singer is a good fit for the group that we're getting ready to go out on tour with. That's all.
Okay.
That's all.
Okay.
I mean, you know, we can't have no wild children out there because it's like, no, because this is a business. This is a business.
Right.
And what they do reflects me as a contractor.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
So
right.
you can't have no wild, you can't have the wild kids out there because it's like, no, it's not that. I don't do those kind of gigs. So, you know, so it's like when you coming with me, you know, keep everything together and we stay together as a group, you know, and it's like we just do what we're supposed to do and that's it because that's the job. Let's just do the job and, you know, other people will see you performing. And then, you know, it's like, oh, as a matter of fact, when I was with a group called Brian Ferry and Roxy Music, my first tour
mm-hmm.
back in the Stone Ages and we were on tour, a worldwide tour, and Sting saw us, the Police saw us, and they wanted the same singers that worked with Roxy Music. Now, I would have been one of the Sting singers, but Juicy Fruit came out, so I had to go out on, you know, my path
right.
was different. But that's it's simple as that. You know, their friends, the artist's friends will see you. It's like, oh, you know, you're coming off tour. Do you think your singers would like to work with us? I mean, it's as simple
wow.
as that. Or it can be complex. Now you got auditions, they got dancers and all that stuff. So, I mean, I never had to deal with any of that. I only dealt with the singers. So,
Okay.
You know, you got to stay ready to be ready. You got to be prepared. You got to be prepared vocally, mentally, spiritually. You know, you got to have something, you know, you got to have it together. You got to have, because
okay.
we have to remember what you represent when you go out there. You know what I'm saying? You got to remember
right.
what you represent.
Right.
And so I try
right.
to find like-minded people that can do the job.
Dig that.
Yeah.
Wow. See, this has opened up a whole new world for me because I never saw it from that side of the coin before. You know,
exactly.
I'm a vocalist.
You only saw it from the front. Even
yeah.
if you knew the Waters and stuff, I mean, you know, it's like, you know, there's a whole nother world behind that microphone.
Yes, you know, it's like, okay, and then, you know, and then, like I said, coming out of the church, you know, I've been in the choirs and things or whatever.
Yeah.
I build myself as a singer, but, you know, I'm still learning some things. I'm okay, you know, and things
but
of that nature.
You never stop learning.
No.
You never stop. Because once you stop learning, it's like you don't need to be singing, you know.
Well, how about that one? Okay.
There you go.
So here is this, because how does it feel for you to have been with the band MTUME? And he's coming. James is coming on the show soon.
Okay. you're gonna love him. You're gonna love him.
Okay. How does it feel knowing that those particular years have produced some of the most the Juicy Fruit and You, Me, and He are still anthems? here within our culture. Here we are, what, 30 years or so plus later. And
yeah,
those
35 years
songs,
later.
Okay, those two songs are still as relevant now as when they were when they first were recorded.
You know,
does
they're classics. They're classics.
Yeah, yeah.
And that's what the people wanted. You know, when we first did Juicy, the record company hated the song. Okay, they didn't want to put it out. Yes, yes. And so what happened was they said, okay, we'll put it out in a Quiet Storm format because of the subject matter. You know,
they thought
you know, and then people heard it during the Quiet Storm, and then they started requesting the song for daytime, and that's what turned Juicy around. The people wanted, the DJs and the people wanted to hear that song during the daytime. So it's like, you know,
girl,
sometimes
the
record comes
in,
right? Yeah, yes. So now you've been hearing Juicy for 35 years, you know?
Okay.
And then people sample it. Biggie sampled it. Keisha Cole sampled it. And so you get another generation of people to hear the song, you know? It's changed somewhat because it should change because, you know, a younger person sampled it. And so they want to put their touches on it. But it's still basically Juicy. I mean, if you're old enough to know, you know it's Juicy proof. So, I mean,
exactly.
I love the fact that people sample because that means more people are listening to the song. You know, so it's cool. So I'm happy to know that I sang on songs that are classics that your grandmother knows, your mother knows, your auntie knows, you know, and the nieces and nephews know. Everybody knows that
they
song.
Do.
They might not know the MTUME version, but they know that beat when they hear it.
Exactly. Exactly.
Mm-hmm.
Now, here we are now in this particular day and age, and we have lost so many. You heard me in the intro, the late, great Phyllis. The late great Michael Jackson, you know, Luther, and Karen, and with some of these folks, it's still so surreal for me. I haven't even mourned Luther's death yet, honey. And believe it or not, I have not because it has not really taken toll with me. You know,
I know, I understand. I totally understand.
How is it that you keep it together, you know what I mean? Because I look at Mama Patti and like when you know folks that who she's touching, when her musical director Bud Ellison had passed and this that and the other, it's like wow, how do you keep it together and say you know what, it's a part of life, we just got to move on, and yet
you
not let it affect you because Luther was such a instrumental part of your life.
Oh, absolutely, he's part of the foundation. The foundation of my musicalness, you know.
Wow.
So Luther, when he passed, I couldn't even listen to the radio because I didn't want to hear his voice, knowing that he was gone. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
It was like, oh.
Mm-hmm.
So, but that's how I dealt with it. But then after a while, it was like, okay. I was thinking about the fun times we had because the man was funny as a, I don't know what. He was hilarious. So he had a great sense of humor, and you know, and he had a different relationship with each of us, but it was family. It was like he was like Big Papa, and we were all his kids because you know he groomed us, and everybody went on to do very well from his core group. You know, everybody went on to do well. So, I mean, we have to keep his legacy going because if it wasn't for Luther, we wouldn't be who we were. He's such a part of us. You know, we have our own individual qualities, but he helped to create what we are today. He helped make that.
Mm-hmm.
He gave me the discipline that I need. And it's like, and I try to pass that on to younger singers that you got to have discipline to be in this business. You know, you got to have discipline. You got to know your notes. You got to know your part. And you got to know the next person's part just in case they miss it. You know, just in
case.
You got to know all the parts. So, I mean, he instilled that in just the discipline of being prepared and looking good and the grooming and all of that. I mean, it's just because it is the business. So Luther leaving, it's like it's very difficult to still accept that he's gone because I hear his music so much and I play his music so much. And just to know that I was there when he recorded certain things, it makes me happy. So that helps me. But, you know, okay. I will always miss him, always. Because I would always wonder where he would be now, you know, where
right.
he would be
right.
now. So, you know, so he's like, for me, he's like one of the greatest soul singers of all time. So,
mm-hmm.
you know,
mm-hmm.
that's all I have to say. Him, Donnie Hathaway, so many people that we've lost. Teddy Pendergrass. Right. Teddy Pendergrass
Teddy.
Did my song with Stephanie Mills. He did Two Hearts. I wrote that.
Yes, I was,
so,
I was just about to go there. Okay.
Oh, my gosh.
As a writer. Oh, my God, honey. Because, see, listen. Okay.
Yeah, I'm gonna,
Two
yeah.
Hearts was it's, and it still is just, I think that it's just one, it's a wonderful love ballad for those
mm-hmm.
who, it's like that beginning stages of love, you know, and when you're
yeah,
thinking about
yeah.
it and romancing and fantasizing about it, okay,
uh-huh.
and you know, met somebody and carrying on and you're starting to bud and let me see where this is going to go. Okay,
right.
Or you're telling your good girlfriend, came into my life, a stranger. Okay,
yes.
You're telling your good girlfriend, I love it. Okay, so I'm like, okay, yes. So as a writer, because you've written for Steph, you've written for Phyllis, you know,
yeah.
And Karen, what is that dynamic for you in the whole realm of being in the music? Because now, you know, you have folks who do your songs, not just you singing, but now folks are wanting to do your work. What is that?
I love it. Let me tell you, it was nothing that was planned. It's just like I wrote this song. I wrote for Phyllis. I wrote for Stephanie. But the thing was, those were projects that were produced by MTUME
mm-hmm.
Lucas Productions. And they... when they had a project coming up, they would tell the band, we've got this project coming up. You submit some material if you want a song on the album. So we all, you know, it was very competitive. So we would all go in our writing corners and write songs and submit songs for them to possibly use on the on their album project. So for Stephanie, Two Hearts came up. Two Hearts was good. So they said, we're going to put this on the Stephanie album, and it's going to be a duet with Teddy Pendergrass. It's like, cool. You know.
Right.
It was as simple as that back then. So, but, you know, that's one of my favorite songs, and I happened to see Stephanie perform it, and I just cried because it was one of my kids, you know, because that was my
uh-huh.
song. So I teared up, you know, while she was singing, because it's like, oh my God, because I had never heard it live before with her singing it. So it's like,
oh really?
Man, yeah, I never heard it. It's so, and when I did hear it for the first time, it's like, oh my God, that's my song. It sounds so good, you know, because she killed it. Of course, she killed it. So it's like, oh man, you know, God is in the blessing business, because it's like,
okay.
That's another thing that you can do, you know, being in the background. You never have to be seen. Look, write those songs, and if you get your songs placed, which is the best thing, you know, that's another revenue for you. You know what I mean?
Right, right.
It's another
right.
revenue. So, you know.
Right. Now, you know, let me ask this question, because this year I've heard about this, and I've always said that great singers look for great singers to support them in the background. They're not intimidated if somebody can sing in that background. In fact,
oh, right,
like Stephanie,
right.
like Mama, you know, they need that. And see,
yeah.
part of them, I watch them so much to where they get off on good singing. Okay, if
absolutely.
You sit up there screaming
yeah.
in their ear, honey, that's they gonna, you know, it's going to send them into the zone. And they're
yeah,
turning around
exactly.
like, sing,
heifer!
And do all
right.
that craziness, honey, because
right.
that's what sends them into that zone.
Right.
But I've also heard where there have been vocalists or whatever who have been intimidated by the background singers or jealous because they feel that the background singers' voices. But I heard Madonna say that once. Not that she was jealous, but, you know, she's always felt that she had to hire folks who sang better than her in her background to make a better show.
Well, you know what? They call the background singers support singers for a reason. We support the main vocalist, so we support the artist. and we are just a cushion that they can use to fall back on, and so they can do what they want to do. It's like, okay, let's say Lenny. Lenny always would have great background singers. So it's like we are the support singers for Lenny. So when he's doing his thing, he's playing his guitar solos, and we're wailing in on the side. It's like people love that, you know, and only very insecure people would be, how are you going to be jealous of your background singers? Didn't you hire them?
Right.
You know what I mean?
Right.
You can't do that. It's like you hired them for a reason. You hired them because they did well, or they made, we're there to make the artist look better. You know what I mean? We're there to make the artist look better. Yeah. So I can't get with that. Why you won't be envious of your background singer? No, you hired them. There was a reason that you hired them, because they were good. Mm-hmm. And they're going to make you look good. You know, they'll make you look better. We're there to enhance the soloist or whoever the main artist is.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, you got to be good, because, you know, because it's nothing better than, you know, you're doing your lead and that support is there, you know, it's pumping you up. That's the best thing ever. Because, you know, you got to have it, like, you know, like in the choirs, right, all the organist is playing, right, the band is playing, right, and everything is thumping, and all you hear is foot stomping, and everybody's sweating, and it's like, oh, yeah,
right,
this is really, really good. So, you know, it helps you sing better.
I am one of the, see, I don't know if I'd be a good background vocalist, because, see, I get caught up. See, I'm a screamer. And carrying on, and I know you say this is the business, but see, I'm going to sit up there, like, girl, you better sing. I've been up there all in that microphone. Okay.
Now.
Sick of me. Okay. I get that note that went up my spine. I've been, girl, sing the song. But
right.
As, you know, but.
But you know what? You have your moment. You have, I call that being in the audience. Because sometimes I would be working with Aretha and listen to her sing. It's like, oh, my God, this woman sounds so good. Until I feel like I'm in the audience as opposed to being on stage with her. So
right.
It's like,
uh-huh.
Oh, man. Because sometimes you forget because it's so good, or it takes you back to a memory, you know, or something. And it's like, oh, my God, she sounds so good, or he sounds so good. It's like, oh, man. Once Ollie Woodson was there singing, and he sang, they did a duet together. And it's like, oh, my God, it's the guy from the Temptations, and it's the Queen of Soul. It's like, oh, and I'm here to witness this. You know, it's like, it's an amazing thing. But if you were singing background, we could work on that. We could work to control your urges to scream out and stuff. We could work on that. But all you need is me standing next to you giving you that side eye. It's like, save that for later.
Keep it aside.
It's like, don't mess up my money. Don't mess up my money.
Right.
Just save that for later. Oh, God.
Okay, right.
Oh, my goodness.
Honey, I could do this with you forever, but I want to just say thank you for coming on. And I want to give you an opportunity to let them know what's coming up for you down the way. And Karen, now, where can we see you? Where can we hear you? What you're working on? What's going on in the world of Tawatha Agee? Where does the name come from? Tawatha Agee. This sounds so like it's an Indian name or something.
It is Indian, and that is my real name. That's what my father named me.
Okay.
So you can imagine what that was like coming up as a little girl. Everybody massacring that first name. Now it's pretty simple. But Tawatha Agee is my real name. Both my parents are alive and doing well. And I asked them, why did you name me that? Oh, we thought it would be nice. You know, it's like, but nobody can pronounce it. That's okay. They'll get it. So, you know, it's cool. That's my real name. But I will be performing on April 28th in Las Vegas, Nevada at the Orleans Arena. And August the 4th, I'll be at the Funk Fest 2018 at the Honda Center in Anaheim, California. And what else? We're working on a new project for a solo project for Tawatha.
Really?
You know? Yes, 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 right. Now when I'm working, I always say I'm Tawatha of MTUME just to refamiliarize myself with the audience.
Yeah.
And, you know, and a lot of times people see you and it's like, that's not the same woman that sang that song, you know, but yes, it is. It's me. It's me. And so we're working on a new a solo project for me. And I think that would probably be, because we're in the studio now. I was in the studio last night. That should be out at the end of the year. The end of the year. Hopefully, hopefully they'll be done the end of the year. So
you have to come back when it's ready to drop.
Oh my God,
I'm hyperventilating. The thing. Oh, wait.
See,
this is why I can't do background. This is why I can't do background, girl.
You get too excited.
Oh!
Okay. It's like me. Sing.
Right, okay.
Oh,
gosh. It's like a baritone bassist. So, you know, there's not a lot of room up there for the baritone bassists like that. Everybody wants them screaming tenors, and that's cool. But, yeah. I've been up into a false of a soprano note just because.
Oh, my goodness. You are too much.
Oh, Lord. I'm telling you. Okay, right, because I'm sitting up here. I'm telling you, I'm hyper. I got to calm myself down.
You got the fan going.
Baby, I'm sitting up here. I'm grabbing stuff. You know how I'm throwing my hands in my face trying to keep from crying and shit.
Right,
and
right.
And carrying on. Okay.
You're a mess.
Damn. Okay. And I felt that in my spirit that you was going to say that. I was like, no, wait a minute. Let me not jump ahead of the thing, Lord, because I don't want folks to, you know. And just, everything. I'm sitting up here listening to that. And see, like I call it Stephanie, my little big sister. That's my baby. You know, I sit up here, and part of my giddiness, too, is that anybody who has touched this woman, honey, or been around her, my mama child, just and are automatically friends of mine, head. And then on top of it, it's because I know what you bring to the table, because, like I said, I have damn near followed you, girl, because, hell, you know, my record collection, honey, is full of you in the background. And to say that we have a new solo project coming out soon, honey, that there is everything because it's just the richness of you. And like I say, your influence, I don't even know if folks know that, but I know when I listened to you and I went and I was putting all this together, it hit me. I said, damn, she was Mickey Howard before Mickey Howard was Mickey Howard. You know.
Well, you know what? Wait a minute now. When was Mickey's first album? When was that?
Mickey's first album was Come Share My Love was 1985, 86, somewhere up in there.
Okay, because you know what? I got a poster of me, and it's like, damn, I look like Mickey Howard. Because, you know, when she had her hair, she used to wear her hair up. And it's like, oh, my goodness. So because my album came out in 83. Mm-hmm. No, Juicy came out in 83. The solo thing came out in 86, 87. I can't even remember. But I know I love Mickey Howard. I know that. That's a singing woman.
Listen, and I'm telling you because I'm listening to y'all vocals, and she loves some you because y'all, there are moments, your voice is so colorful and it's such a presence. To where that's what I was hearing. I was like, oh, child, wait a minute. This is a Mickey Howard right here. I was like, oh, wait.
Oh, wow.
I had put that correlation together, and I was like, oh, and I started telling a friend of mine, I was like, child, this girl was Mickey before Mickey was Mickey, honey. Look at this. Listen to this. And carrying on. And then You know, I'm telling you, yeah, okay, I'm just a music lover like that, honey. And
I see.
And then when it tickles me, honey,
I'm really serious about this.
Girl, I really, music is God's perfect language, and it touches everybody, and it's omniversal. It is completely omniversal. Okay,
yeah.
Because I don't care what it is. I don't care what it is that you do. There's a song for good, bad, or indifferent, honey. There's a song
there
to express that moment, that feeling, that flavor, that whatever. And music does that. I really believe that those who are blessed with the gift of song or the gift of music, because you may not sing, maybe you write, maybe you produce, maybe you edit and can mix it down or whatever. That particular element, honey, is what keeps us all, it unites us, and I really believe that there is the beginning of how we can heal the world, because we have so many messages out there. And as you can see, when gangsta rap hit, you see how the tone changed of the world. It changed because it had a message, yes, but then that message started to permeate and it started to speak to folks. To where now we have an angry kind of society. Music nowadays is kind of angry. You know,
it is
very self-sufficient. You know, it's the instant gratification kind of stuff now. And I would love for music to...
I'm hoping it'll come back around.
It will. It has no choice, child, because they get tired of it. You know, it's just like a baby. When the baby's screaming and crying so much, when you put it down and stop giving it attention, it's going to go to sleep. Then shut up.
No, I hear you. Listen to you.
So with that, my darling, if you have any kind of social media where you want to let the people know where to find you, to whatever, let everybody know how they can get in touch with you right now, my sister.
Okay, my website, TawathaAgee.com, beautiful website, that Mr. Ellaby helped me do, as a matter of fact. And also on social media, Tawatha on Instagram and Facebook, it's at Tawatha Agee, one word.
Okay. I'm supposed to be going down your website because you have these jewels that you have up there. That's why I took the agent as optional. Okay.
Oh, yeah.
Getting old is what is it? Getting old is
inevitable.
Inevitable,
aging
but aging is optional.
Yeah.
When I read that, I was like,
cool when we're old. See, I want to be cool when I get old. So, you know.
Yes, I live for that.
My darling,
let me let you go because, like, as you can see, talking is a hobby of mine, and I can sit down here. I would. Okay, and I would get you up here, and you'd be sitting up there looking like, okay, you know what, cute? That's cute, baby, but you fucking with my coin, girl. I got to go.
Oh, you are hilarious. I love it.
Okay.
I'm so glad I did this today. Thank you so much for allowing me to talk to you.
Oh, honey, and I'm telling you, when this album is ready to drop, Angelo know already. He already know. He know I'm crazy. So, yeah, I need you here, girl. I need you here because I will dissect every song. I'm telling you, we have a listening party right here. The thing I'm telling you.
Oh, my goodness. I'm looking forward to that. That sounds something sounds like something we should do.
Oh, darling, I'm telling you now. I'm telling you. I got to. I don't know what this is. I can tell folks the song to release. I'm like, I call myself a B-side bitch. I'm the B-side girl. Okay, the song that's on the B-side should have been the releasers. Yeah, that should have been the lead one. That's the one. I'm that girl. So yes, girl. Yeah, we'll do this.
You are a mess. Oh, Big Meech,
I love you,
mess.
Baby.
That's all
and
I can
thank
say.
You.
I love you. You're a lovable mess. I love it.
I'm not healthy. I'll take that. Okay.
Yes. I love it.
Well, thank you, baby, for your time, and thank you for just spending a little bit with me and dishing your tea with me, honey.
I love it. I love it.
Okay.
That's all I can say.
Now.
Yeah.
Oh, I could exhale now. I'm about to cry and care now, but I'm gonna do that off camera.
Well, we were tea sippers for a few minutes. It was I enjoyed it. I thoroughly enjoyed it. Thoroughly.
Thank you, baby.
And
we gotta do it again.
Thank you.
I'm telling you, yes, we will. That's in the cards. That's inevitable. Okay.
Oh, like aging.
Exactly.
Right.
Exactly.
Oh,
okay.
My God.
Thank you,
okay.
Baby, so much. All right.
You're welcome. Take care now.
Oh, you too. Bye-bye.
Okay, bye.
Oh, children. Oh, that was Miss Tawatha Agee, honey. I'm telling you, my God. Oh, wasn't that just fabulous? Okay. I'm going to get myself together because I am in school. I'm supposed to be in class, but that's all right. I'm here till 5 o'clock anyway, so it don't matter. But in any event, my darling, please look her up, TawathaAgee.com, and carry it on, honey. I'm telling you, go to her website and go to her page, honey, and it has all of her it's a section, and I'm trying to remember the section. But when you get to it, it has all of her personal anecdotes and things that she lived by and quotes that have sustained her. She has stuff up in there, honey, that holds her as a singer. And I was going to go down and go down the line, but Spirit didn't lead me that way today. When I first started doing this, I said, okay, I'm going to go to the website. I'm going to be cute and pick this out. But no, Spirit didn't lead me there today. So I'm telling you, go to her website and get some of those. Josh, she got some jewels. Oh, excuse me. She got some jewels up there, baby, that will sit down there and will permeate your soul. And it's really, 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 really helpful, and it's very inspiring. So go do that for me, and we will call that grace, okay? So listen, I got to get back up in here, baby, because, yeah, they think I'm losing my mind again, and slightly I am, but that's all right. So, honey, listen, finish all of your crumpets, my darling, because the tea has been dished. And you've been dishing tea, my darlings. Ha! With Big Meats. If you love me, honey, tell a friend. If you hate me, tell an enemy. But do know this, one way, shape, style, form, or fashion, everything that I'm doing will move forward. So now, you know what, on that particular note, now I should close with Juicy Fruit, but you know what, that's the one that everybody knows, but I want y'all to really get into her. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to close with one of Tawatha's songs from her solo album, since she's got the new solo coming out. So what I'm going to do, yeah, we're going to do, oh, this is a fun one. Yeah.
All lines are still busy. Please hold.
I went ahead and let you know I would die for you. And oh, couldn't do. I went ahead and let you know I would die for you. Then you called me crazy. I didn't know what to do. I want you back, baby. I'm putting my love on hold for you.
All lines are still busy. Please hold.